Okay, we'll start a 10-second countdown. How's that? Five, four, three, two, one. Okay, here we go. So ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce our next keynote speaker, the commander of the Air Force Space Command and my former wing commander, General Jay Raymond. General Raymond oversees two operational networks, both the cyber network and the satellite command and control network. He executes multiple satellite missions, as well as the missile warning, missile defense space surveillance mission, and also executes the space launch mission. He has the opportunity and blessing to lead 38,000 space and cyberspace professionals across 134 locations. It is my distinct honor to introduce to you General Jay Raymond.
Good morning. How's everybody doing? Kind of a cool place to talk. I was down in the green room, and they have all the bands that have played here, you know, sign on the wall, Foreigner and Beach Boys and all this. And they actually, in the green room, actually have a place where you get your hair done. I didn't have to use that this morning. But it's great to be here. I've really been looking forward to this for quite a while. And I think the theme for today's event couldn't be more fitting. The future is now. And that requires us to move out with a sense of urgency in our cyberspace operations. Venues such as this allow us to do just that. And I'm glad to hear everybody talking, because you're going to get way more out of that than you are going to get listening to me. This is what makes these conferences so good, the connections that you get to make and the information that you get to share and the dialogue that you get to share with each other. I want to thank Lieutenant General Suedo, Lieutenant General Quast, Mr. Aldridge, and their teams for pulling this together. This is, again, an extremely critical event and an extremely critical time. And I must say, I'm really glad to be back in the South. I went to the Harvard of the South, Clemson University. I wish I was here next week where I could watch Clemson whoop Auburn. But I don't want, you know, not making any friends here. They say don't tick off the crowd, but what the heck. Yeah, I was reflecting on my time at the Harvard of the South as I was preparing for these remarks. And when we've come a long way. And when I was at Clemson, I was a junior, in between my junior and senior year, before I first saw a computer with a mouse. And I was taking a summer school class. That's where all the smart kids went, to summer school. Taking a summer school class, and a guy from Apple brought in a demonstration of this computer. I think it was Apple, I can't remember who it was, but it was some company brought in. And I didn't take any of those classes that you really had to use the mouse or use the personal laptop. I was on the mainframe computers. And I remember, this no kidding, I would take a class and some of you have heard me tell this story before, but it's true. I would, you would type on punch cards, and you'd get this big stack of punch cards, and you'd stick it in a hopper, and the hopper would, you know, and the cards would slide through, and then there's a big, huge printer with paper about this wide, and it would go chunk, 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 and it was like a Christmas tree would come out, and it's like, woo! I won, you know, it looked like a Christmas tree. And a cyber attack back then was when your college roommate, mine was Jordy Jordan, would take your cards and put them in the wrong order, which would really tick you off. And it wasn't a Christmas tree, it was like a pumpkin or something, or a Christmas tree that was bent over, and then you'd really have problems. But it's kind of, with that as a background, here I am, the head cyber guy, and let me tell you right now, I'm not the head cyber guy. I'm responsible, but you all are the experts. And I'll tell you, what I'm here to talk about in all seriousness is, I think we need to transform your business. And I've been in the transformation business before, and when you're transforming your own stuff, it's kind of hard. And so I hope I don't insult anybody here, and I hope I challenge your thinking. That's what I'm going to try to do, challenge your thinking, trying to think through other ways of doing business. So, if you go to the next slide, God, that's scary. Go to the slide. All right. So, if you look at that slide, you see the core missions of the Air Force down on the bottom. They've pretty much been enduring. There's been slight name changes throughout the years since 1947, but they've largely stayed the same. But how we've executed these missions has changed significantly. And to do so in providing global vigilance, global reach, and global power. So, my question is, when you look at that slide, where's IT? Do you see that in a core mission? No, you don't. It's kind of a trick question. It's not in our core mission, but it's everywhere. Everywhere. You all see all those little lightning bolts? None of that happens without cyber. That connectivity is what gives us our strength. You hear about multi-domain operations. You are the DNA of multi-domain operations. Nothing happens unless you can get connected in this information age. In today's wars, ones and zeros are as critical as JP-8 diesel fuel or bombs. Information is power. You see, as a joint force, our interconnectivity is what gives us strategic advantage in any kind of joint military operation, whether it's humanitarian assistance, disaster relief, all the way up to high-end conflict. Our ability to project air and space superiority worldwide at a time and place of our choosing in order to achieve our objective, it requires us to collect information from all corners of the globe, to disseminate that information to our decision makers and to our war fighters, to mobilize and deliver our forces and connect to any point on the globe within a matter of hours, to execute strike missions from halfway around the world, command and control our forces, and to connect them on a global scale. That is what sets our American fighting forces apart. That's what gives us our lethality. That's what gives us our advantage. And it's a luxury that we've had and that we've employed for over two and a half decades. But what happens if all that goes away? If we cannot connect all these capabilities together, if we can't do machine to machine, machine to warfighter, what does that picture look like then? The satellites become a piece of space debris, along with the 22,000 other pieces of space debris that we're tracking each and every day. GPS becomes a huge clock in the sky that nobody can tell time with. The critical shipments don't make it to theater uncontested. Collateral damage increases because our munitions accuracy will be degraded. The data collected has no way of making it down from orbit and therefore is unusable. Our banking systems would be unable to execute transactions. This picture would paint a very different story. Our combat power would be dumber, it'd be slower, it'd be less lethal, and the clarity of the battlefield would erode. Make no mistake about it, this would impact not only our American way of war, but it also impact our American way of life. The importance of cyberspace is not just ones and zeros, and it's not just our email and secure comms. It's the interconnectivity between the warfighter and machine. That is our strategic advantage. However, our potential adversaries have had a front row seat watching us for the last 2.5 decades, and they understand our American way of war. And to be honest, they really don't like what they see. So if you're a potential adversary going up against the United States, you know you're going to have a hard time matching our fifth generation aircraft in the air. You know you're going to have a hard time taking on our powerful Navy. You know you're going to have a hard time facing our superior ground forces. We're the best joint force in the world. So where are you going to turn to? You're going to turn to areas that may not be easy to attribute and where you think you can have advantage, and I would argue that's in space and cyberspace. I would ask this question. Where would you rather fight the F-22 or F-35? In the air or in the wire? So today I want to talk to you in my role as Air Force Space Command Commander and tell you what we're doing to transform Air Force cyberspace to organize, train, and equip our cyberspace forces to accomplish our missions today and into the future. But first, you got to talk about where we've been. And it's important to note, when we started IT, initial IT networks flourished because they were open and ease of use was prioritized over security. Today, however, these networks are true extensions of the battlefield, and today this terrain is contested. So how many in here cyberspace communications folks? Raise your hand. Probably everybody. For those that have been around for a while that are wearing a blue uniform, you spent your formative years focused on comm and computing, right? That's where you grew up. You focused on support activities, largely not warfighting activities. And this isn't meant to be pejorative by any means. It's just the way it has evolved. It is a function of time and change. But today, we're shifting that focus, not simply due to the criticality of the communications and the challenges we face in a more automated world, but rather there's this, as we talked about, risk reliance calculus that we're currently facing. A forced reposture, in my opinion, is required to improve our defensive position. In essence, we are adjusting the arrangement of our forces in time, space, and purpose. So I always do this, and for those that, when I've done commander's calls, if anybody's here from 24th and you heard this in commander's call, just go with me, because some of you probably haven't heard it. How many people have commercial email? This is always a dangerous story to tell in a crowd like this. Raise your hand. Everybody's got it. Okay. It's really hard to see with all these lights. How many times has that commercial email ever gone down? Can anybody raise your hand if your commercial email has ever gone down? I see a couple hands. That's more than what I typically get. You got to come over to my service. I don't remember mine ever going down. Maybe I don't use it as much, but I don't remember it ever going down. Let me ask the same question. How many people have AFNET? Chuckles. You know where I'm going with this. How many times has it gone down this week? And it's not because of our bad airmen. Our airmen are spectacular. I mean, absolutely spectacular. But we haven't architected this right, and what we're doing is throwing really good airmen at a problem. And in my opinion, it's kind of like the blue bear. Remember when some of you have kids and you take them to the doctor, or some of you remember when you were kids and you went to the doctor and you had to get a shot, right? And the doctor held up a blue bear to distract your kids while they're giving them a shot? I think this is our blue bear. I think we're spending way, way too much resources and way too much airmen, too many airmen, protecting unclassified email. And we should be focused on warfighting and protecting our weapon systems, which in my opinion, is something that's going to be way, way more important in the future. So what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about where I see this headed and where I'm trying to lead our command and lead the Air Force to shift this way. And there's currently three parallel things that we're working on that are mutually supportive Air Force initiatives that I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about. The first one is called Enterprise as a Service. If you go to the next slide. Yeah, right there. Go back slide. I just realized I don't have to look up. There's one right there. I can look right there. Enterprise as a Service. I want to be really clear up front. This isn't about cost savings, although I don't think it's going to cost us a whole lot more. And it might cost us a little less. Who knows? This is about warfighting. This is about securing our advantage as a multi-domain force. This is about making sure that we have an information platform of which we can operate off of. And when y'all chuckled when I said, how many have AFNET, that's telling. It means we don't have the right thing. And so I don't think, as I said up front in the first slide, I don't think IT is an Air Force core mission. It wasn't on the core mission slide. We need it. It's critical to everything we do, but I don't see it as a core mission. I think we can procure that as a service. And then I think we can focus our airmen into other things. If you look at this, there's three kind of big bins. There's networks, our installations, and our weapon systems. And currently, if you look at the little stick figures, the vast majority of our airmen fall way over into the network side. And don't quote me on this, I don't have the numbers exactly right. But I think in the Air Force, there's roughly, again, don't quote me on this, 30,000 airmen doing comm stuff. 30,000. That are communicators or cyber specialists. Of that, how many do you think are core cyber? Less than 2,000. I think we're out of balance here. So we are rapidly exploring the idea of leveraging commercial industry to do the IT piece of this. Originally, the Air Force was in the business because there was no one else that could provide these services. But today, industry is, in my opinion, is the experts, are the experts in this. For For close to the cost of parity, we can leverage the innovation and speed of commercial industry to do this work. Simply put, we are expending a lot of resources, both, as I talked about, both dollars and airmen, on something that we haven't done very well. And again, it's not the airman piece of this. We haven't resourced this right. We haven't architected this right. We have not, by any means, spent what industry has spent on doing this. We may rely on IT-dependent platforms, but that doesn't mean that we have to be the provider of IT itself. IT is a commodity, in my opinion. No different than gas, water, or power, which are also very, very essential to our missions. We can retain what we hold absolutely essential to warfighting and leverage industry for the rest. This approach allows us to buy our airmen back, to be refocused on missions that are inherently military, that are in line with Air Force core missions. You know, we're a pretty small Air Force. And the value of every single one of you wearing a blue uniform is extremely, extremely high. I don't need you having to do something that we can leverage out and have commercial industry. Don't misunderstand me on this. I'm not saying we get rid of all of it. There clearly is a time and place for airmen to do that job. For example, when we're deployed in a warfighting environment, that's where combat comm comes in to extend that communications when we are projecting power on the other side of the world. You know, we already do this in other aspects of our Air Force. We're looking in Air Force Space Command on the space side to contract out flying of a satellite bus and focus our airmen on fighting the payload piece of that. We do it in CE. We have Red Horse that goes in and fixes runways. There's bases here where we do, where we contract out fixing streets and things in our bases back home. I think similar analogies can apply to IT. So what are we doing? First thing we have is we called the cloud-hosted enterprise service, CHESS. And so today, we have just less than 100,000 airmen. I think it's, as of 24 August, 97,000 airmen that have their email, SharePoint, Skype, and something else in the cloud. And it's working really well. Nobody gets your mailbox is too full anymore email or little notification. We've transitioned that to a cloud environment, and our goal is to get the entire Air Force to have their email in the cloud and all those other services in the cloud by this year. I don't know if we'll make it, but we'll be close. That's the goal, get everybody's email into the cloud. The next piece then is long-haul comm and leveraging commercial long-haul comm to do that. And then the third piece is all the base comm infrastructure piece. And so this is our first step. We're well on our way, again, having good success. That leads us to the second initiative, and that's refocusing our airmen to defend our installations and our weapon systems. It's centered on an active cyber defense model designed to deliver mission assurance in a contested domain against a thinking and maneuvering potential adversary. How many people have heard about the Cyber Squadron Initiative? This is along that same lines. You know, to shift our airmen to more cyber, to more of a cyber mission focus than a network service focus. We've developed, you know, we're standing up in the Air Force along with our other joint partners, our cyber mission teams and protection teams. We're well on our way to that. We've also stood up what we call cyber mission defense teams, and those are integrated into the operational units that they support. They're tailored, trained, and equipped and tasked, organized to survey, secure, and protect this key cyber terrain for those wings. The HAF has funded 15. Air Force Space Command and Air Combat Command have funded 17 of these teams. That's where the newly refocused airmen are headed, in my opinion, into the MDTs. If you can get out of the traditional comm squadron business and shift those airmen over into protecting our weapon systems, I think we'll be better off. This is commander and mission focused employment model. Let me give you an example of this. The 50th Space Wing, located at Schriever Air Force Base, they operate a worldwide communication network to control all of our satellites. We have stood up a mission defense team as part of the 50th Space Wing, focusing on protecting and ensuring that we can command and control those satellites without interruption. They provide the wing commander with an understanding of that critical cyber terrain of that global network. If you think about it, they are like the analogy that we use is they're like the beat cops. They're the ones every day on the scene checking to make sure we're secure. And then when we need the FBI to come in, we bring in the cyber protection teams for a little bit greater work. We really have to get these mission defense teams right, and we have to give them a level of capability that will allow us to protect ourselves each and every day. The other piece of this is what we call the CROWS, Cyber Resiliency of Weapons Officers, of Weapons Systems Office. And that is the third transformational initiative, is focused on just that, building resiliency into our weapon systems from the beginning. It's, you know, it's not added on after a weapon system is delivered, which is a lot tougher. It's building it up from the beginning. It requires us to future-proof our new acquisition projects, making them capable of operating in the face of an evolving strategic environment. It also requires us to focus on current systems and perform threat and vulnerability assessments and provide recommendations for mitigating those risks to make the weapon system missions assured. I envisioned 10 years from now a change in how we do and what are the critical questions that a wing is asking. So today, if you go to a wing stand-up, questions will primarily, in a flying wing, will primarily focus on aging fleets, standard parts, components, and hardware. What was the last time we changed this part? What was the maintenance inspection schedule? What is the estimated time of completion? What's the impact of the loss of this aircraft? Think about this in the future. If you have cyber squadrons, now it's not only those questions, but it's when was the last time that software was patched? When was the last time that we have found any malware on our systems? What is the malware? What is the impact? The bigger picture is, if you get, and I'm jumping ahead here, but if you get to multi-domain operations, traditionally today, multi-domain operations means taking space and cyber and making their domain better. Multi-domain operations, where we're going, is kind of domain on demand. What domain can you get the best effect using and then use it? How do you carry out the five core missions of the Air Force and do that in both space and cyber and air? And then how do you integrate them together? So let me just kind of wrap up here by talking about training. And as I stated at the beginning, our airmen are the cornerstone of our ability to execute our Air Force core missions. And I don't want anybody in this room walking out of here thinking, boy, he doesn't like how we operate the AFNET. You are spectacular. You are keeping us alive. But in the end of the day, I'd like to shift your focus. So let's talk a little bit about how we do training pipeline. So there's some people, unlike any other domain, I think I can say this, everybody that comes into the Air Force, when they come into the Air Force, you have operated in the cyber domain before you came into the Air Force, right? Everybody's been on a computer before. Now, some of you are like me. If Control-Alt-Delete doesn't work, I'm done. I'm a cyber dinosaur. I told you, I'm punch card king. Some of you come in and you have master's degrees from pick a university in computer science. You are way more savvy, smart. You might be computer engineering. You might have been an airman first class or airman that came in and that you've spent your time in high school building computers. You might be way more tech savvy than I'd be. But typically how we do training is just everybody starts off and everybody does the same training. No matter if you are a tech-savvy airman with a lot of experience or you're me. And we don't think that's right. And with the help of Air University and AETC, we're transforming how we do that. So if you're one of those smart airmen that come in that have a lot of experience in this, you can take some tests, get some assessments done, and you can clep out or get credit for these blocks, and you just have to do what you need to get into your job and be effective. I'm really excited. I'm really excited about that going forward. We have already seen examples where we have modularized this training, and we've had some airmen test out of about 50% of the course. And we're looking to do this, and as an Air Force, we're looking to do this, and Air University, I'm here preaching to the choir. You're the ones that are doing this for us. We're looking at a continuum of learning that allows us to give this customized just-in-time training when you need it. And cyber has really been the beta test for this effort. If you go to the next slide. So multi-domain operations, back to where I started. I think if you say, hey, we've been doing multi-domain operations since we were a service, 1947. You know, we've been focusing on integrating air with ground and naval forces. We've been focused since 1991 after Desert Storm of taking strategic space capabilities and integrating them into the fight. We've been focused here recently on taking cyber and integrating cyber into theater operations as well. We have to take this to the next level. It's on a global scale. It's in a contested environment. It's not just space and cyber impacting air and ground. It's all domains coming together to support, and it's figuring out which, as I talked about up front, which domain can provide the best effect in the timing and the tempo that we need in employing it. That this is a warfighting imperative, in my opinion, that we get this right. It's a national imperative that we get this right. I really believe that every one of you in our cyber operators, every one of you needs to embrace this and help us move forward. We have got to figure out how best to employ you in this new warfighting environment that we face. In my personal opinion, it's not about pulling comm wires and setting up networks. It's about protecting our weapon systems and protecting our ability to bring lethality to bear when our nation needs it. So with that, I think I have some time for question and answers. I hope we get a robust dialogue going. We need your help. Let me just say thank you to each and every one of you for your service. As I mentioned up front, the value of your service is higher than it has ever been in the history of the Air Force, in my opinion. There's not a lot of you, and you're doing spectacular work. And I'm just very, very proud to serve alongside of you each and every day. Anybody here from Texas? My thoughts are with you and your family if any of you have been impacted by the storm. That's a tough deal, and I know it hits hard at the core of our cyber capabilities down in San Antonio, but I hope you and your families make it through with little impact. All right, with that, any questions?
Yes, sir. The U.S. is a network-based military, and it's the foundation that enables operational actions. What is the Air Force doing to properly test and measure the network to keep it operating as it is designed?
That's one of the things. So where are you?
Sir, she's right in the back of the stage.
Oh, there you are.
These are email questions.
You know, we're doing a lot. You all are doing a lot. I'm going to turn the question around a little bit and say, what should we be doing? In this line of work, typically, we just did a big program review down at in San Antonio. And if you look at using our traditional acquisition models for cyber, in my opinion, isn't the right answer. And so we have got to figure out how best to acquire, how best to test capabilities that have to move really, really, really fast and have to evolve really, really fast. And so I think we're doing a lot. You're doing a lot. It's a lot of hard manual labor. A lot of that goes on down at 24th Air Force. But I think we really need to, as part of this, take a step back and say, how do we test, and should we be the ones doing that testing, or should we, in this case, and part of this, leveraging commercial industry to do that?
Cam Granger, please read the next question.
Sir, how do we balance encouraging innovation and rapid adaptation with treating cyber as a weapon system?
I don't think it's mutually exclusive. I really don't. Let me give you a couple examples. When I was in Japan in 2011, Japan had a big earthquake, nuclear reactor disaster, and a tsunami, and then a nuclear reactor disaster. And we were providing humanitarian assistance, disaster relief to our partners in Japan. And we were really struggling with how do you model radiation dispersal across the country. We had instruments set up to measure, but we didn't have a common operating picture, if you will, on how to do this. And it was really impacting us. We were struggling. We found it, the Air Force had a different view of it than the Navy. we had a different view of it than Japan, and we would have really benefited of having a common operation picture in how do you display this radiation. We couldn't figure it out. So I was sitting at my desk one day, and I was thinking, hey, how about, I wonder how Google would do this. So no kidding, Brigadier General Raymond called Google. I was in Japan, I called San Francisco. I said, hey, I'm trying to figure this out. How would you do it? They said, you know, we have a place in Tokyo, Google Tokyo, that they've got hundreds of people that are helping support Japan. They'd love to help you. So I got in a helicopter. Within 20 minutes, I was in a helicopter flying up to Tokyo, landed right by the helipad where we land. There's a big, huge high rise. That building is where Google Tokyo was. Walked over to the building, went up to the 30-something floor, met in a white room, and these two young guys with laptops come in. I said, here's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to model radiation dispersal. How would you do it? And they, I'll never forget this. I was just fascinated by this. They open up their computer and they, let's get, I'm making this up, John from San Francisco up, ping. John appears on the wall. And let's get Sue from somewhere else, ching, she's up. And these four folks with laptops figure this out in about 15 minutes. And they said, sir, here's how we do it. I said, man, that's just what we need. How do I do that? And they said, well, if you know the computer language Python, and I'm like, Python, I'm card punch guy. they said, or if you can get somebody, we can teach them this in a couple days and you'll be good to go. So I flew back to Yokota, put an all call across 5th Air Force for Python speakers. And we got two. There was a lieutenant at Yokota, and this is a true story, this is funny. And a young airman at Kadena. He had just come in the Air Force. And so we flew a C-12 down to get this airman. And this was the most strategically important airman in the United States Air Force on this day. And this is the funny part. We fly a C-12 down to get him, and he shows up. And typically when you're going on a C-12, you show up at passenger terminal, they weigh your bags, and they gotta be 35 pounds or under. Well, he shows up with like 50 pounds of bags, and they sent him home. We sent the whole plane down there for him, and they sent him home because his bags are like, where is this kid? And so they go find him, said, you can bring whatever you want to bring, just get on the plane. and we fly him up. Can you imagine this? I mean, I think he'd been in the Air Force for less than a month. Fly him up on his personal plane. He gets in a helicopter with this lieutenant. They fly down to Google, and they learn how to do this and input this into Google Maps. And I think in 2 or 3 days, we were up and running. Now think about if we tried to do that as an Air Force. It would take that long to do the staff summary sheet to get somebody to figure out how we're gonna move forward. We have got to figure out how to do this faster. Let me give you another historical example. Not in the cyber business, but this will resonate with you. So, in the space business, Bernard Schriever was the father of the ICBM, and really the father of space. And how long, so he took a band of people together, brought them to LA, in what they called the little schoolhouse, and they built, designed, built, tested, operationalized all the ground infrastructure, all the ICBMs, all the training, all the checklists. How long do you think that took them? Anybody have a guess? It's about 5 years. About 5 years. So let's pretend that Lieutenant General Suedo is a GPS satellite, okay? And I want to go buy another Lieutenant General Suedo just like him. Just another GPS satellite. Or let's pretend that General Wegeman is a cyber satellite. I want to buy one just like him, just clones. No matter what satellite it is, guess how long it takes to buy a clone? Anybody guess? It's about 6 years to buy a clone. That changes, it varies a little bit, but roughly, it's about 6 years. If I want to buy another General Suedo with a different arm or a different leg, that's like 10 years. For General Suedo, it might be 50 years. But it's 10 years.
How do you go fast? And in cyber, where things are moving like this, how do you go fast? I think we've got to figure that out. And I don't think, going back to the question, I took a way long route, if I even remember the question, I don't think weapon systems and moving fast are mutually exclusive. I think we have to figure out how to do that. And we have to figure out how to do that. And it isn't going to be me figuring it out. It's going to be you figuring it out. Let me tell you another story. This is the way you can keep from answering up more questions, just tell stories. Let me tell you another story. There was a lieutenant at Patrick. And I went down to visit Patrick Air Force Base, and I meet with airmen and then CGOs, and I was eating lunch with CGOs. And they go around introducing themselves, and all of a sudden they have a question. And this one lieutenant asked me, "Sir, how come we can't renew ID cards online? You know, I know I'm from the state of Virginia, and when my driver's license expires, I can go online and I can get a new driver's license. Why can't we do that with ID cards?" I said, "Hey, great idea. Let's talk about it. I'll set up a VTC where you can brief me on your idea." So I go back home, and a few weeks later, I said, "Hey, we need to set up this VTC with this lieutenant." And she said, "Well, sir, they've already started. They've actually already done it. And in Florida, if you were a dependent of a retiree, it was taking 6 weeks to get an ID card. 6 weeks. They implemented this online business, and they got it down to, don't quote me on this, it was like 4 days, and the actual touch labor when the person showed up at the MPF to get their ID card, pick it up, was like 5 minutes rather than an hour. I said, "Well, I'll tell you what, rather than do a VTC, why don't we bring her here and have her brief me on this? And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to surprise her, and I'm going to say, hey, you're going to come to Washington with me, and you're going to brief the Air Force leadership." And that's what happened. So she shows up, and I had to have a way to have her in service dress. So I said, "Hey, tell her I'm a really mean guy, and he makes everybody brief him in service dress." So she shows up in service dress, sits at the table, gives me the brief, and I say, "Hey, that's spectacular. I think there's room for this, you know, across our whole Air Force and the Joint Force." I said, "What are you doing this afternoon?" And she said, "Well, sure, nothing, I'm going home." I said, "No, you're going to come with me, you're going to go to Washington." And I said, "We're leaving in 30 minutes. And we walked down, got on the C-21, we flew to the Pentagon, she briefed the Air Force A-1, she gave the elevator speech to the Vice Chief of Staff, the Chief of Staff, and since that time, briefed the OSD joint ID card people, and now they're looking at making this going across the whole Department of Defense. But this is an airman that is smart in their business, bringing up ideas to make change. And we need to do that. And the people that can do that are sitting right here. It's not me. It clearly isn't Wegman. All right. Another question. Voice from the back.
Sir, will the congressional proposal to start a separate space force dilute our efforts in space and cyberspace as a force?
Putting on my space hat now, just like the things that I talked about in cyber, the same thing applies in space. Space, for the longest time, has been a benign domain. As long as you could get a satellite into orbit and it would survive the launch and work, you didn't have anything to worry about. Today, space is very congested, contested, and competitive. And just like in cyber, there is a range of threats that potential threats that we're facing, everything from low-end reversible jamming of GPS and communication satellites all the way up to what China demonstrated in 2007 when they shot a missile and blew up their own weather satellite. And so the strategic environment in space has changed. It's really, really, really important to our joint force, just as it is in cyber, that we can protect and defend these capabilities and provide them to our warfighting partners. Congress wants to help us. And they have pointed out some really, they've been very helpful and have pointed out some things that we need to do better on. We need to be able to go faster. We need to figure out how to professionally develop the Air Force of 2030, the multi-domain force that we've become. I don't think we have that right. We need to figure out the resources associated with this. And so I applaud very much, the emphasis and the focus on this. We'll see how this plays out. You know, the Air Force has been in the space business since its inception, for over 60-something years. And in fact, this September, September 1st, Air Force Space Command is 35 years old. And our Air Force has built the world's best space program that we have today. We have integrated space into everything that we do. Largely, if you go back to Desert Storm in 1991, where we first saw the benefits of integrating space into theater operations, you saw GPS enable the left hook through the desert, you saw strategic missile warning satellites being able to detect tactical missiles. You saw precision weaponry for the first time, enabled by GPS. Remember General Schwarzkopf and General Horner out on the doing newscasts, and I remember him talking about the luckiest guy in Iraq who just went over the bridge as the bridge was swept. We got a taste of that. And since 1991, that's been our focus. My whole career has largely been focused on integrating space into theater operations. It's not good enough anymore. You got to do more than just integrate. You need to be able to protect and defend. And that's really where Congress's focus is, and that's where our focus is on. We have made a lot of changes. Last week, we stood up an A-11. A three-star general officer is going to go into the Pentagon every day focused on space. In December, I will become not just the service component to STRATCOM, but I will also become the operational component to STRATCOM. We're going to stand down JFCC space at Vandenberg and move those responsibilities to me. And so we have already made some pretty significant changes going forward, and we'll see how this plays out. But I applaud the emphasis. We have got to get this right. We have got to get this right in both space and cyber. Next.
Sir, there are no more questions.
Oh, thank God. Thank you. Thanks for letting me be here. I want to wrap up with saying I don't want any of our comm experts, comm professionals, cyber professionals in this room to take my comments wrong. I'm proud of you. I'm really proud of you. You have kept us going. You have, that slide isn't up there. You wish it was up there so you didn't have to look at this. That multi-domain slide, you've enabled that. Now we've got to sharpen, in my opinion, our operational focus to make sure that we can deliver that without fail. Again, I think the network piece is our blue bear. I think we can leverage commercial industry and focus you more on that slide, which is so critical to us. Thanks for letting me be here. I appreciate the opportunity, and I hope you have a great rest of the week. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, General Raymond.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, you're released for your break and then out to your respective breakout areas. Please note the exposition hall will be opening shortly and is located outside the doors to your right. Our next keynote speaker will be the Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, Kalith Wright. Please be in your seats on time for that briefing at 1350. Thank you.